So welcome, everybody. My name is Megan Ruciano. I am the beneficiary advocate here at the Arc of Northern Virginia in the Special Needs Trust Program. I provide support services to our trust clients. It can mean anything from you need help applying to Social Security to, hey, what's this Medicaid thing and how do I apply, to I need help accessing more integrated employment. You can hire me as an advocate and I can help you obtain those things. But I'm here today with Dana Trainum from Disability Law Center, Virginia, Virginia's protection and advocacy organization, and we are here to talk a little bit about alternatives to guardianship and supported decision making. So I'll let Dana introduce herself, since you probably know yourself a little bit better than I do.
Okay.
And she's going to start us off by talking about the alternatives to guardianship, and then I'm going to pitch in quickly at the end to talk about some of my experiences with supported decision making. So welcome.
Good morning, everybody, and good morning online. I am Dana Trainum. I'm a senior staff attorney at the Disability Law Center of Virginia. How many of you have heard of us, the LCV? We used to be the Virginia Office for Protection and Advocacy, VOPA. We were known by that by several years. I'm not going to go into too much of what we do. We are the protection and advocacy organization in Virginia, which means that we work with federal grants in order to advocate for people with disabilities all over the state and all sorts of disabilities. My area of expertise at the Law Center is personal decision making and self-determination. So in talking about that, guardianship comes up, and I like to talk about alternatives to guardianship. We will touch on guardianship today and what that is and what it means, but mostly we're going to be talking about how to avoid that process in the first place. So the first thing we're going to go ahead and get the test out of the way. You told them about the test, right?
Sure.
You got
test, guys.
All right. Well, you're going to have to wing it. It's only two questions, so maybe you guys will be okay without studying. Who is the expert on you when it comes to medical decisions? Who's the best person to make decisions about your health care? Good. Okay. See? You didn't even study. You got that one. Okay. The second one's a little bit harder. What if you're in a situation where, either because of injury or illness, you're not able to communicate what your decision is for health care? Who then is the best person to make that decision?
My wife.
Wife, husband?
Power of attorney.
Okay. Power of attorney. Tell me what do you mean by that?
Well, my partner has a durable power of attorney for me and vice versa.
Okay.
Which includes medical and other types of decisions.
Okay. So who would be making the decisions?
I would, as long as I was able.
Uh-huh.
And if I were not able, she would.
Okay. And building on that, I think the answer to the question is the same as the first question. I am still the best person to make decisions for myself in that situation. How do I do that? I do it by thinking ahead. I do it by putting things in writing ahead of time. Either choosing someone who's going to be that voice for me, because they're going to be my voice to make the decisions that I would make if I could have made them at the time, or I'm going to put things in writing to say, if this happens, this is what I want, and this is what I don't want. So let me ask you this. I'm going to try not to go too far down the morbid road today or too far down things that are hard to think about, but let's say you're at the doctor's office and he has just given you a new diagnosis. And it's a serious diagnosis, and you need to come up with the decision on how to deal with that, with the different options that you have available to you. What are some of the things that you're going to do as you're trying to make up your mind about that?
Educate yourself about whatever diagnosis you're getting.
Okay. So educate yourself.
Yes, and then consult to the one you trust.
Okay, and consult the ones you trust. How are you going to educate yourself?
Finding out through looking for information on the internet, asking your doctor more questions, going to a specialist.
Okay. So you're going to go on the internet, which can be pretty scary when you have a new diagnosis, right? You're going to ask your doctor for information. And you're going to talk to people that you trust. Any other ideas of what you might do?
Make sure you have a will.
Make sure you have a will. So you're going to get your things. Those sort of things make you think about what you need to do to get your affairs in order.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes that's a catalyst to get us moving to do things that we haven't done.
Get a second opinion.
Get a second opinion. So we're going to seek out other ideas, other opinions. Any other things that you might do? Any of you pray? Talk to someone maybe in the religious realm? Okay.
Let your family know.
Let your family know. Any of you have a BFF? You going to be on the phone with your BFF? How many of you are going to be putting it on Facebook saying, hey, guys, I got this big decision to make? I've got friends who, you know, basically don't go to the bathroom without posting it on Facebook. So we have different ways of getting information. Do you know what you just defined in a very loose sense? Supported decision making. What you just defined was a way that we incorporate supported decision making in our lives all the time. Even if it's not such a big decision, you know, just an everyday decision that I might need to make. I've got my mom on speed dial, okay? She's my support. I've got my friends. Those are my natural supports. So when I have a decision to make, I utilize supported decision making to do that. So how many of you guys are parents here with individuals with disabilities? Okay. A lot of times, the folks that I work with may not have family support, and so they may not have that natural support system. What I was just talking about was our natural support system. People that we naturally have in our lives, our friends, our coworkers, people in our church, people that we know through clubs and organizations that we're involved in. Sometimes the folks that I work with don't have that. They've lived a very sheltered life. And so a lot of times, they have to have a more artificial support system. And that has to be put in place by advocates and people who can put together that artificial support system. But we can still do supported decision making with that, with people that care about those individuals. And Megan's going to talk more about supported decision making, so I'm going to leave that with her. She's got some examples that she's going to share with you. But I just wanted to do that example in the beginning to show you this is not some nebulous thing that we're talking about. This is something we all do. We just need to find a way to use the same types of support in order to support people with intellectual disabilities to make these big decisions in their lives instead of making the decisions for them. Let's talk a little bit about vocabulary because I'm going to be using some words today, and I want to make sure that we're all talking about the same thing when I'm talking about these words. Can anybody tell me what the word capacity means? And I don't mean how many people fit in the room, but mental capacity.
Maybe level of functioning, how high they could function.
Okay, level of functioning, how high somebody functions. Any other thoughts on what capacity is? I think of it, the definition that I found that is easiest for me to understand in the work that I do is that in order to have capacity, an individual has to be able to do three things. They have to be able to take in information, and that's however it is they take in that information. Sometimes when I'm meeting with an individual I've never met with before, I need to figure out how is it they best take in information. Because if they need a sign language interpreter and I don't go there with a sign language interpreter, I'm not going to get very far. And if they speak Spanish and I don't, then I'm not going to get very far. So I need to know how is it they best take in information. And then they're able to make a decision based on that information and then communicate the decision. Again, however it is they communicate. I have worked with many folks over my career who were nonverbal. Nonverbal does not mean non-communicative. Nonverbal means that they communicate in a way that is different from using the voice the way that I use my voice. So however a person is able to indicate to me that they've made a decision about what we're talking about, if they can do those three things, they have capacity to make the decision that's before them. When I'm talking to professionals sometimes, or I'm reading client charts, like in hospital settings or school settings, a lot of times I will see a sentence that says, this individual lacks capacity. It's a pet peeve. peeve of mine. I get pretty angry when I see that because it is an incomplete sentence. Does anybody know why that's an incomplete sentence?
Capacity for what?
Exactly. I mean, we have, how many of you have made a decision today? Every one of you. You made a decision when your alarm went off. Am I going to get up and hear what this lady's got to say, or am I going back to bed? You made the decision to get dressed. Thank you. You've, you know, we all made decisions just to get to this point today. And different decisions that we make require different levels of capacity. So when I see this person lacks capacity, I'm like, do they lack capacity to know whether they like green beans or peas? Do they lack capacity to know where they want to live? Do they lack capacity for making complicated medical decisions? Because those are all different levels of capacity. Capacity changes regarding the decision that needs to be made. It also sometimes changes over time. I see this more so in the mental health community. A lot of times I'll work with folks whose capacity may change over time depending on their stability level, their, you know, are they on their medication, are they in recovery, or are they in a crisis mode. I see it in the elderly population. Sometimes capacity changes from morning to night with someone who is elderly. Capacity may be totally different in the morning than it is in the evening. Capacity changes over where we are. So sometimes I will go meet with a person, and if I have them come into my office, I see a totally different level of capacity than if I go to their home where they're comfortable. So I tend to go to people's homes because that's where they're more comfortable and that's where they're more likely to be open with me and talk with me. They may totally shut down if they're in an office setting. So capacity is this fluid thing. So whenever, if anybody ever says to you about your loved one, well, he lacks capacity, I want you to say that's an incomplete sentence and correct him on that. One important thing to know is that capacity is presumed. And our law says that. Virginia law says that a person has capacity until they've been deemed not to have capacity. The law is pretty clear, meaning that if the person has not been declared incapacitated by either a court or a doctor, then that person has capacity and is able to make their own decisions. When does a person gain the capacity to make their decisions? At what age?
18.
And does it matter what the person's ability or disability or IQ is? No. When that person turns 18, they are legally an adult and they are making their own decisions legally. And that's sometimes where supported decision making comes in. Has anybody here ever met an 18-year-old who's able to make complicated life decisions?
Not good ones.
Not good ones, okay? I think back to when I was 18. Oh, man, I got my first credit card, and I remember thinking it was free money, and, you know, not good. So that's where supported decision-making comes in. We do it for our kids that are going off to college. Right? Hopefully they allow us to do that. And so for people with disabilities, it should be the same thing. Now, when I went off to college, I was able to make that mistake, and it was a mistake to get that credit card. I was able to make all kinds of mistakes. How do we learn best sometimes? Through our mistakes. Do we allow people with disabilities to do the same thing?
Not usually,
no. What happens when a person with a disability makes a mistake? We start talking about guardianship. We start talking about we need to protect them, okay? Hopefully not after you leave here today. Hopefully we'll be thinking about things differently. We all need that ability to make mistakes, while being protected at the same time, just like I did when I went to college. But so often we jump right to guardianship and think that we need to protect that individual. I'm trying to stay with the slides so that people online can keep up with us here. So back to vocabulary. Anybody tell me what is an advanced directive? You didn't know you guys were going to have to talk today, did you? What's an advanced directive? Any thoughts?
Stating some of the things that you would like to happen if your capacity is limited.
Okay. So stating some things that you would like to happen if your capacity is limited in some way, like I said, through injury or illness, something that might happen in the future. Okay? That's absolutely right. I think of advance directive as being a general term. It's kind of the umbrella term. And in Virginia, we have different things that we can do as part of our advance directive. Let's talk about those different parts. The first one is a power of attorney. You talked about a power of attorney. What is a power of attorney? What do we do in a power of attorney? Yes.
Give someone else the ability to act on our behalf.
Okay, so we give someone else the ability to act on our behalf. Did you have something to add to that? Okay, that's exactly right. That's what we do with the power of attorney. We choose the person we want to speak for us if we ever get to that point where we are not able to speak for ourselves. That's the power of attorney. And we're going to be talking quite a bit about power of attorney throughout the presentation. Also, within an advance directive, we can do a living will. Does anybody know what a living will is? Yes?
I believe it's so that you can make clear what you want to have done in the event that you're reaching the end of your life.
Right.
Or if that would also include things like if you're in an accident and you're put on life support, do you want to remain on life support or do you want to have the machines turned off?
Okay. Perfect. That is the perfect definition of a living will. For those of you online, I will try to repeat it just as well. So it puts in writing what kind of care or treatment we want or don't want if we are at the end of our lives, either because of incurable illness or significant injury. In Virginia, end of life also includes if we are in what's called a persistent vegetative state, so like a permanent coma state. What kind of care or treatment do we want and what kind of care or treatment do we not want? So we're talking about extraordinary care versus hospice care or palliative care. So either life support to keep me alive as long as possible or just keep me comfortable until I die naturally. That's what we're talking about in a living will. So that's specifically for end-of-life care. Okay? So the parts of an advance directive so far, power of attorney, living will. Up until 2009, that was it. That was it for Virginia. Those were the two things you could do with an advance directive. In 2009, our law changed and allows medical directives now. Anybody have an idea what a medical directive is? A living will is a medical directive, but it only covers end of life. A medical directive is when we put in writing what we want or don't want. So a living will is a medical directive, but only for end of life. In 2009, Virginia expanded that so that we can do a medical directive for any type of medical care. You may have heard, how many of you have heard of psychiatric advance directives or PADs? Okay. Back in 2009, 26 states had adopted psychiatric advance directives, and when the group that was looking at changing Virginia law looked at that, that was the thing, you know, should we do psychiatric advance directive in our law? And what the group decided was, why are we going to separate out psychiatric? You know, that's kind of like cutting off our head and not thinking about the rest of our body. Why are we only going to talk about, you know, the mental part of things? And so Virginia was the very first state that has what's called an integrated medical directive, meaning that we can talk about any health care in our medical directive. Yes, sir?
What was insufficient about a power of attorney that made the medical directive necessary?
Okay, so what's insufficient about the power of attorney that made a medical directive necessary? I would say absolutely nothing. And personally, if you can have both, I think you have the best of both worlds. What happened a lot of times for folks that I was working with before 2009, they didn't have anybody in their lives that they trusted to name as in their power of attorney. The person, I was getting ready to say agent, but I didn't define the term. Agent is the name of the person I choose to make decisions for me in my power of attorney. So a lot of the folks I work with, especially in the mental health community, substance abuse community, they've burned some bridges over their lives, and they don't have anybody to name. So So they really couldn't do an advance directive. Back then, we did what I called statement of values. So they basically did a medical directive. This is what I want and don't want, but it wasn't legally enforceable. So in 2009, now it's legally enforceable. So it's great for people who don't have anybody to name in their power of attorney, but it also is a good supplement even if you have a power of attorney, because it guides the agent in what we don't, what we want and what we don't want. It also can keep your agent from going too far afield, because if I put in writing that I do not consent to a certain medication, then my agent doesn't have the authority to consent to that medication either. So it puts some limits on my agent, as well as guide my agent in what my decisions would be. So I think it's great to have both. A lot of times when I work with folks who have more physical disabilities as opposed to mental health or intellectual disabilities, they tend to do both. When I'm working with folks with intellectual disabilities, a lot of times power of attorney is the only thing that we do, is to choose someone to make decisions for them. And it's all a la carte. It's based on what works for you as you're, you know, thinking about your future.
And we have found through bitter experience that although we have a power of attorney for our son, it doesn't work when he's in a psychiatric hospital. They just reject it out of hand. They say they need a psychiatric advance directive. They will not accept the power of attorney.
Are you here in Virginia?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, can we talk after?
Sure.
Okay. Because a power of attorney is covered, covers all health care, not just physical health care, but it also covers mental health care. That's why we have an integrated form. That's why when the law was changed, they decided to go with an integrated form. So let's talk after. Okay. So the parts of an advance directive, can anybody name them? What's it under that umbrella of an advance directive? Power of attorney, living will, and medical directive. Okay. And you can have one, two, or three. Or I suppose you could have none. 85% of us don't do any of these things. So hopefully it won't be 85% of you guys, but 85% of Americans don't do this. And when you're looking at the mental health population, that number reaches 99%. And the most interesting statistic I saw was that hospice patients, when do you enter hospice? When you should be knowing you should be getting your affairs in order, right? Still less than 50%. Okay? We don't want to think about this stuff. We don't ever want to think about this stuff. But it's important that we do. All right. So let's talk a little bit about power of attorney. We've talked about the person that I choose is my agent. When I'm thinking about choosing someone to make medical decisions for me in the future, what do you think I should be thinking about? Let's say I'm going to write a newspaper ad, wanted agent for my power of attorney. What are the qualifications that I want to list?
Somebody who's healthier than you are.
Okay, somebody who's healthier, physically and mentally, maybe, I don't know.
Somebody who's responsible and cares about you.
Responsible and cares about you?
Yeah. Somebody you trust.
Trust, yes. I would put trust in all caps, yes.
To be an advocate, it's important, especially in the hospital, and we need an advocate.
To be an advocate, yeah. And sometimes being an advocate means asking hard questions, yeah. And it means disagreeing with the doctor, right? Oh, my. And so thinking about those things when you're choosing who's going to speak for you. Another thing that's important to think about is that. Who is going to speak for you? Who's going to speak for me? Not who is going to do what they think is best, okay, but someone who is going to be my voice and do what I would do if I were able to do it in the moment. And that can be hard for some people. And that is a conversation that I recommend people have with someone that they're choosing as their agent. You know, let's say I don't want to be on life support. Are you going to be able to make that decision when the time comes? I had a couple that I worked with. They were of the Jehovah's Witness faith, and I don't know a whole lot about it, but they explained to me that they can't take blood products. Even if it would save their lives, they do not take blood products. And they have three kids, and they wanted to choose their oldest son. They said he had the most level head on his shoulder. He was the most responsible. He was the one they trusted the most. He was the only one of the three that had left the faith. And so they were a little worried about that because they said, you know, if I were to get into an accident and the doctor said all your mom needs is a little blood transfusion and she'll live, otherwise she's going to die, I don't know if my son can make that decision. So I was able to write their power of attorney so that their son had the ability to make all of their medical decisions, but he had no authority to consent to blood products. And we put that in red in the power of attorney. So I tell that story for one reason, is to tell you you can write these however you want. And we don't have a set form in Virginia. You can be creative, like that was creative. It gave them what they wanted, but also protected them. And it also protected their son. He wasn't put in that situation where the doctor came and said, you know, you could save your mom's life. So that's the great thing about Virginia is we don't have a form, and you can write it however it meets your needs and your family's needs. today we're talking about healthcare power of attorney. You can also have powers of attorney for financial decisions. So that someone can handle your finances for you. You can also have a power of attorney for educational decisions. I do this sometimes for families whose student in the family has an IEP, and when that child turns 18, those rights transfer to the child. And sometimes the child needs help with those decisions. And I've worked with children that want really nothing to do with it. Don't take me out of gym class to come to my IEP meeting. Just let my mom handle it. And while we certainly encourage folks to attend their IEP meeting, it is their choice not to. So we can do an educational power of attorney as well so that the parents continue to have that right. Okay. A couple other things going back to the agent that I didn't talk about. One is willingness to do it. Whenever I'm sitting down and helping people write this, and they say, well, I want my Aunt Susie to be the person who makes decisions for me, my first question is going to be, have you talked to Aunt Susie? And if you haven't, do you want to, we could do that together right now. On my own ethics, I don't write a person's name in as an agent unless that person has been spoken to and has agreed to do it. Some states, actually, the person has to sign the document saying they agree to the responsibility, and I think that's actually a good thing. We don't have that in Virginia. But you don't want someone to get a call at 3 o'clock in the morning from a hospital and have that then find out that you've named them to make complicated medical decisions for them. It has to be a conversation. It's something they have to be willing to do. And throughout the hundreds of these that I've helped people with, I've only had one time that an individual said, no, I don't want that responsibility. So I'm really glad we asked before I wrote the document. So once you've chosen who the agent is going to be, before we get to that, let's say I choose, in real life, I chose my wife Nancy as my person to make decisions for me when I can. Guess who I spend a lot of time with? Guess who I ride in the car with quite a bit? What if we were to get into an accident and we were both unconscious? I'm her agent, she's mine. What happens?
I became my parents' agent.
Okay.
I was the subsequent.
Okay, so you were the...
So when they both went down, that's what happened.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you can have more than one in line so that if something happens and Nancy's not available, then it would go to Christy. If she's not available, then Mary. Then it goes, you can go down the line. I've had folks ask me, well, I have two kids. Can I just name both of them as co-agents? You're shaking your head. Tell me why.
Have you ever met my sister?
The answer was, have you ever met my sister? No, but I've met my brother. Yes, if you have two people named as your agent at the same time, that's called co-agent, you are asking for trouble. You're actually asking for the same trouble you're trying to avoid, because both of those people would have to be notified, and they both have to agree.
Yeah, and even when they're not named as agent, and you make a decision, then they're badgering you about the decision.
Right, so even the person who's not named as an agent, they're still going to badger you about the decision, and that has to be something to think about when you're choosing your agent. My mom has spoken to me and said, you know, Dana, you're the person I would want to be my agent. You know me the best, and I would trust you the most. But to be quite honest, I know that your brother, Mike, is a bully. And I don't know if I want to put you in that situation. So my mom and dad are actually, right now I am their agent, but they're considering having someone outside the family be the agent for that reason. So that we're not then bickering, you know, as mom's laying sick in the bed, we can concentrate on being her children and not making those big decisions. And I don't have to deal with my brother the bully.
Does the power of attorney have to be, does that person have to be a resident of Virginia?
Okay. The power of attorney, the person that you choose as your agent, does that person have to be a resident of Virginia? Very good question. No. We're a very mobile society. And so we always, probably every one of us in here, have one of these little tethering devices we call a cell phone. As long as the person is reachable, it doesn't matter where they live. As long as they are reachable. Because a lot of the stuff is done by phone.
Because in the case of an executor will, if the executor is out of state, there has to be a co-executor within Virginia.
Right. And we don't, yeah, when it comes to a will, the rules are very different. But when it comes to a power of attorney, no, the person does not have to be in this state. Okay? In the back?
We have two questions from webinar people.
Okay.
The first one is, can you have a different agent for each type of power of attorney?
Okay. So can you have a different agent for different powers of attorney? Yes. Absolutely. In my situation, you know, say I were to choose, I have two brothers, say I were to choose my brothers. One I would trust with my health care, I would trust with my life. But I don't want him anywhere near my money. Okay? And Mike, a.k.a. the bully, I trust with my money. I mean, you know, he's a corporate lawyer. He gets the money piece of it. But I don't want him deciding my health care. Okay? So, yes, you can have different people for different types of decision that needs to be made. And there's such a thing as a general power of attorney where people try to put all this stuff together in one document. That's one reason why it doesn't work really well. If you try to put financial and healthcare all together in one document called a general power of attorney, because a lot of times you are going to use different people to make different types of decisions in your lives.
Yeah.
Yes.
One more question. Our spouses automatically.
Okay, are spouses automatically agents? So that's going to bring up the question of, this is why PowerPoint doesn't work for me, because we're just going to skip to this part of the presentation, because it's a good time to talk about it. If I'm one of those 85% that doesn't do this, and I get into a car accident on the way back to Charlottesville today, and I can't make my own decisions, who's going to step in and make decisions for me? Any ideas?
Next of kin.
Next of kin. Okay. Both of you are right. It is next of kin, and Virginia defines what next of kin is. So if I'm in that auto accident, first off, if I'm able to make decisions for myself, obviously I'm doing that. If I am unconscious and they need to do something to save my life, they're not looking for anybody to give consent for that. They're going to stabilize me. They're going to do what they need to do, up to and including surgery, to save my life. But then when they get me stabilized and other things need to be done, that's when they're going to start looking for somebody to give consent if I'm still unconscious. They may look at our state registry of advanced directives to see if I have an advanced directive in there, if they know who I am, and they know how to look for that. Other than that, they're going to look to see for my next of kin, and that is spouse is number one. Okay? I mentioned that I am married to a woman. Is that recognized in Virginia now?
Yes.
Yes? I really didn't think it would happen in my lifetime, but it did. So she is my spouse legally, and she would be making decisions for me if I did not have an advance directive in place. Do we have common law marriage in Virginia? So if I live with someone for 40 years and we buy a house together, we have kids together, everybody thinks we're married, am I married in Virginia? That's called common law marriage? No, we do not. Okay? So that person would be a stranger under the law, so they would not make medical decisions for me, and in some circumstances may not even be able to visit me in the hospital, okay, unless I have put something in writing. What is that something? The power of attorney that we're talking about today.
That's precisely why my partner and I have got a power of attorney in 1993. That was the option.
Right, right. Before gay marriage was recognized, that was the option. You put it in writing, you do a power of attorney. Okay? Yes?
Going back to the different agents for different types of powers of attorney, in your experience, have you run across that separation where a medical decision had substantial financial implications and somehow the two agents have to work that out.
Yeah. Right. So we're going back to if you have two different agents for financial and healthcare, obviously some healthcare decisions have financial ramifications. Well, pretty much any healthcare decision has financial ramifications. They do have to find a way to work together, yes. But I will say that if someone says they want a certain type of healthcare, that's going to take precedence over how it's going to get paid for. Okay. Okay, so going, yes.
All the documents so that if something should happen to you or your spouse, for example, somebody in your family actually knows who is the real power
okay.
attorney or where the documentation should
so
be.
So where do we keep the documentation? Let's go through the list of decision makers and then we'll get back to that.
Okay.
That's a very good point. So I'm in this accident. I am not, let's say I'm not married or I'm not legally married in Virginia. Now who's the doctor going to look for to make medical decisions for me?
Sibling or a parent?
Sibling or a parent, there's somebody before that.
Child.
Your adult child. What if you have more than one?
Older.
Ah, most common answer. Still wrong. Virginia law says that the doctor may go with the majority. Okay? So I'm going to give you free legal advice. Are you guys ready? I should see pens up. How often do you get free legal advice? Are you guys ready? Have an odd number of children. Yeah, for some of us that ship has sailed. But in all seriousness, this is where I get on my soapbox, because this is where families get fractured, this is where they fall apart, and sometimes they never get put back together again. They're like Humpty Dumpty, okay? And if you ever say yourself or you hear somebody else say, oh, well, my kids know what I want. I don't have to put this in writing. My kids know what I want. You know, we're all tight. We're good. Hit yourself. Don't hit the other person that says it in front of you, but tell them to hit themselves. Because when mom is sick in the bed, you're going to see sides of people you have never seen before. And if mom has two nickels to rub together, you're definitely going to see sides of people you've never seen before. So we do this to protect ourselves, but we also do it to protect our family members. Okay, don't leave people guessing about what mom would want or dad would want when that time comes. Put it in writing. So, so what if I'm not, let's talk a little bit more about kids. We have many different types of families today. What if I married a guy and say he was a widower and he had a baby at the time and I raised that baby as my own, would that child be making decisions for me when that child becomes an adult? Unless what? Unless I adopted that child, okay? Once I adopt a child, then that child is as if they were, as if I gave birth to that child. They have the same legal rights. But a stepchild does not have the right to make decisions. For me, a foster child does not have that right, only my birth children and children that I have adopted. Now, What about my daughter-in-law? Okay, no. Good news, ladies. Neither your daughter-in-law nor your mother-in-law will be making your medical decisions for you unless you specifically give them that right in your power of attorney. And for some reason, that always rings true with the ladies. I don't know. Okay, so I'm in this accident. I can't make decisions for myself. I'm not legally married. And let's say my children are under the age of 18, so I don't have adult children. Who's next?
Siblings.
Somebody before that?
Parents.
Then siblings. Okay. What if I have more than one? The doctor may go with the majority. Good. Now, I want to stress something that I say there. The doctor may go with the majority, meaning he doesn't have to. The court is always an option if the doctor does not wish to go with the majority. And why might the doctor decide to go to court rather than going with the majority?
So he doesn't get sued.
So he doesn't get sued. Right, by the minority that didn't get what they wanted. Okay? Again, if you put these things in writing, you don't have to worry about who's in the minority and who's in the majority, because you've already made the decision. Okay. What if I am not legally married, I do not have adult children, my parents are deceased, and I am an only child?
And you're lonely.
I'm lonely. Then we're looking at cousins, aunts, uncles, blood relatives at that point. In Virginia, we also have something called the next friend. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on that. I've never known it to be used. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of it being used. You have to jump through so many hoops to be considered a next friend that I don't foresee it being used that often. If you get down to the next friend situation, really should think about doing an advance directive and naming who that person is going to be. Yes?
Can you explain a little bit the majority at that point in terms of what you mean by that?
Okay. So if my mother is in the hospital and a decision needs to be made about whether or not to keep her on life support or not, I am one of three. So the doctor can say, you know, Mike, Gary, Dana, what do you think we should do about Mary? Should we pull the plug or, you know, what would she want? And my brother Gary and I say, you know, she wouldn't want to live like this. So I think you should, you know, we need to let her go. And my brother Mike would be very adamant, no, you know, she would want to live as long as possible. I'm not ready to say goodbye. He would say keep her on life support. The doctor may go with the majority at that point and go with the two over the one.
Okay. And that's with siblings, and that's also with
siblings and children.
And children.
Yes. Kind of hard to do with parents because you either have one or two. So.
What if there's only two and they disagree?
Then there is no majority, and then the doctor would really have no choice. He would probably go to his hospital ethics committee, and then once they make a decision, they would present it to a judge. And the judge would make the decision. How many of you want a judge making your medical decisions?
No.
What's the way around that?
Do the
advance directives, okay? So I know you guys probably all thought you were coming here today just to learn about how to support the individuals that you support with intellectual disabilities. You guys didn't know that I was going to be talking about you guys and what you need to do for your own life protection. Surprise. That's the thing about advanced directives. It's a wonderful tool for people with disabilities because it can give them a voice when otherwise they wouldn't have one. But I can do this presentation to any group, and it will be relevant because we all need to think about this. We could all become incapacitated at any moment. Yes?
The medical directive, is there a standard form for that?
There are forms. The question was, are there standard forms for the medical directive? There are forms, but there is no, say, magic form. There is no form where we can say the form. Okay, so there are options.
Excuse me, I know my son was in the hospital, but
Yeah, the hospitals all have that. Is that right?
Yes, the hospitals, since 1999, all hospitals are required when you register, even if it's for day, for some sort of day surgery, or you're being admitted, and you probably all had this happen when the registration person asks you, do you have an advance directive? And if you don't, would you like one, and would you like any assistance in filling it out? A 1999 federal law requires that any hospital that takes Medicare or Medicaid ask those questions. So that's why they get asked. And yes, they will give you a form. Most of the time, the form that the hospital gives you are forms you're going to find online, or you can even find them at Staples or Walmart. Those are going to be forms that come straight out of our legal code, that come straight out of our law book. You know who writes that stuff? Lawyers. Okay? Fortunately for me, I missed the day when they removed English from my vocabulary, and I still speak pretty good English. But a lot of lawyers can't for the life of them say something in plain English anymore. And it's true for the document that's in the code. If there's anybody online that was involved in writing that, I was just kidding. I actually went through, in Microsoft Word, you can do a readability statistics. I did that on that form that's in the code book, and it's written at the Harvard Law Review readability level. I didn't go to Harvard. So I actually have created a form that I think is in English, and it's a form that I'm perfectly willing to share, and it's the form that I use when I meet with people with disabilities to help them to write these things. So there are forms out there. There are many options for forms. Just find one that works for you. You can also write it out. If you feel comfortable just writing it, you can do that as well.
I mean, is it possible just to go to one's lawyer that has done, like, a will and have them do it?
Yes, you can. So is it possible to go to a lawyer such as one who has done your will and have them do it? A lot of times it's done as a package deal. They'll do your will, they'll do your advance directive, they do it all as one package. You do not have to go to a lawyer to have this done. You do not have to involve lawyers at all. How great is that? Because I think anytime you can avoid seeing a lawyer is a good thing. So you can find a form that works for you. I'd be more than happy to share my form and do it yourself without having to involve a lawyer or paying a lawyer for that matter. So before we get to what we do with the copies and how we keep our documents and let people know that we have them, let's talk about how to make this all legal. In Virginia, there's only one thing that you have to do to make the document legal, and that is to sign it in the presence of two witnesses. That's it. Once you put your wishes in writing and you sign it in the presence of two witnesses, it is a legal document. So a lot of times I get the question, does it have to be notarized? No. Virginia does not require a healthcare power of attorney to be notarized. I recommend it, but it doesn't have to be. So don't let that stop you from, just signing it in the presence of two witnesses.
Are these two witnesses could be your family members?
The witnesses can be your family members, yes. One thing that I do recommend is that the two people that you choose as your witnesses are not the same people you chose to make decisions for you. I think it's cleaner if a person only has one job at a time. So if they're going to be your agent and they're going to be making medical decisions for you, choose two other people to be your witnesses. Okay? They don't have to know you. I did mine. I took mine to the bank, and two tellers came in, and they were my witnesses. They don't know me. I've done them in a nursing home setting where I stood in the hallway and waited for a couple of people to walk down the hall and said, hey, can you help me out here? So they don't have to know you. What they're witnessing is you signing it and not being coerced to sign it, that you're signing it and you're doing it willingly. Yes?
This can be addressed later, but because it's related to signing, I'd like to ask it now.
Mm-hmm.
In the context of entering majority and in the context of a physical disability where the individual cannot physically sign, at some point today you talked about the mechanics of the day before, the day of, the day after the 18th birthday, and how you do all this and substitute signatures so that guardianship can be avoided.
Okay. So as far as signing it goes, signing is it can mean making a mark. You have two witnesses, so if the person is making their mark with it, however they do that, again, those two witnesses are witnessing the fact that that individual is doing it themselves. So I have had people do it with a pen in their mouth. I've had folks who had to have someone hold their hand like this, you know, to support, physically support the hand so that they could sign it. But they made their mark, and they did it willingly. Yes.
Have you ever done it with eye gaze?
I have worked with folks who do eye gaze to make the decision, but even then, a lot of times they have a way. I've even seen people that use stamps that has their signature on it, and they use it that way. But I have worked with people who have communicated to me through eye gaze what it is that they want me to write in their advance directive.
Well, I meant specifically the mark. I can draw out a circumstance where it may not seem coerced, but there's no physical way the individual would have initiated the movement to make any physical mark. It may be able to communicate a desire through eye gaze and what needs to be in the room for that signature to be considered legal.
Okay.
If I can no longer sign it, you know, as a parent because the individual is no longer a minor.
So legally, if the person...
Worst case scenario.
Worst case scenario. First off, I'm not there when the person signs it because I communicate with the individual. They tell me what they want. I go to my office. I do it, and I mail it to them. So I have never physically seen how the person signs it. But I would say that if a person is not physically signing it in some way, shape, or form, and by signing, again, I mean they making a mark on the document, they can't put a pen between their lips and you know, have the paper in front of them, then I would say the witness component becomes even more important. And in that situation, I would probably want to write down not just to see the witness's signature, but print their name and their address and phone number so that if it is ever questioned whether that person had the intent to sign it, you're covered. Otherwise, the witness just signs it, and I can't tell you the name of the people that witnessed my document because I can't read it. But that would become more important in a situation like that where it may be questioned in the future. Yes?
Just to recap, advanced directive, so all that's needed to make it legal is two witnesses, right? And you're referring to all of the advanced directives, power of attorney, living will, medical directive, the psychiatric advanced directive, and that's it. And then you don't have to get it notarized, and this is all in the state of Virginia.
Yes.
So for all of those.
Now, I will say for a financial power of attorney, there are some differences, especially if you're going to be dealing with buying and selling real estate, okay? Then a notary may be necessary, and in that situation, I do recommend that you see an attorney to write those sort of documents.
Okay.
My clients don't own and buy and sell real estate or stocks and bonds and stuff like that, but I do understand that there are notary requirements for some of those things. But for healthcare, no, notary is not required.
Can you go into the psychiatric advance directive because we didn't get to that?
Okay. So a psychiatric advance directive, remember, we don't specifically have that in Virginia. It is incorporated within our integrated medical directive. And within that medical directive, I can talk about care or treatment that I want or don't want. So examples. I live in Charlottesville. We have two hospitals. If I get sick or injured, I want to go to Martha Jefferson. I do not want to go to the University of Virginia. That is a preference, meaning that it will be followed if possible. Example, I was rebuilding our banister that our pit bull destroyed, and the very last cut on that had a really sharp tip on it. And I didn't want that sharp tip to, you know where this is going, don't you? I didn't want that sharp tip to hit the sidewalk when I cut it with a skill saw, so I put my hand under there to catch, yeah. So I cut my finger off. And so when the rescue squad came and I said, yeah, I want to go to Moss Jefferson, I don't want to go to UVA. And he says, do you want that finger back on? And I'm like, yeah. He said, well, we're taking you to UVA, okay? UVA is a level one trauma center, and they have microsurgery, so that was able to I have all my fingers. So it's a preference. Same thing for psychiatric hospitals. You know, if I have to go to a psychiatric hospital, I want to go to A, not B. If B is the only one that has a bed, where am I going? I'm going to B. So I'm giving my preference about what I want. I can do the same thing, doctors. I want to work with this doctor, but not that doctor. Well, guess what? If the doctor I don't want to work with is the one that's on call that weekend, are they going to have to call in a different doctor? No. So I can give a preference. So if there's two doctors on call, give me the one that I'd rather work with. I can put in my medical directive either consent or refuse to consent for medications. That is not a preference. That is a directive. If I say I absolutely do not want to take Seroquel, then the doctor cannot give me Seroquel. There is an except. We'll get to that. The doctor cannot give me Seroquel, and my agent cannot authorize the doctor to give me Seroquel. It is just as if I told the doctor face-to-face, no, I refuse this medication. The except to that is an emergency situation. If there's an emergency situation and a medication that I have refused is the only medication the doctor feels that will resolve the crisis situation that I'm in right then that medication can be given to me. But otherwise, it cannot be. That's a directive. I certainly want to put in my medical directive any allergies or bad side effects that I've experienced with medications. I think of the medical directive piece as being me talking to my doctor at a time when I'm not able to talk to my doctor. And so, again, for folks, especially those folks with mental health issues and mental health recovery and they're in crisis mode, that's what I mean by giving them a voice when they don't have that voice. Because they put these things in writing when they're doing well, okay? This is what works for me. This is what doesn't work for me. I can put in there if I'm in a crisis situation, these are some of the things that work for me. Being in a quiet room, listening to music, calling my mom on the phone, playing with my rattlesnake, you know, whatever it is that calms me down. Now, I mentioned the rattlesnake as a really obscure example. I can put that in my advance directive. Does that mean the hospital has to let Petey come into the hospital? Absolutely not. Okay, that would be against the law, actually. I can't play with rattlesnakes. But I can put that in there. I had I used to do that as a joke. And I had an occupational therapist in my audience one time, and she said, no, I really think people should put that in there for real, because as an occupational therapist, if I see that, then I may have other pet therapy situations that I may be able to utilize. No, you can't bring in Petey the rattlesnake, but maybe I can bring, you know, Sam the hamster. Maybe that, you know, I don't know. Or if I say in my medical directive that getting a massage every day by masseuse Sven really calms me down. You know, the hospital is not required to do that. But again, taking what the OT said, put it in there. She said, you know, I can train people to do self-massage techniques, and maybe I would make an appointment with them to work on that. So anyway, these are the sort of things you can put in your medical directive. How do I feel about ECT, dialysis, chemotherapy? I mean, the sky's the limit as far as if there's something important to you about your medical care. It's you talking to your doctor and telling your doctor what's important to you, what works, what doesn't work. Because again, who's the expert on you? You.
Is that the same thing as an outpatient advance directive, which is specifically for psychiatric illnesses?
I've never heard of an outpatient advance directive, but in what we did in Virginia was just took all of those things that limited the advance directive to only certain places and only certain parts of our body and certain diagnoses, and we said, you know what, let's just cover everything. So that's what we have. We don't have specific advanced directives for specific diagnoses or places or things like that. I mean, I guess you could, but you don't have to.
It's appropriate to have your primary physician, for example, to have a copy of the medical directive just in case your agent or your power of attorney can't be reached, but you have your doctor who knows you very well is familiar with everything that you've outlined so that they can reach, if there's an emergency situation, reach someone who knows you and knows what you want.
Exactly.
I don't know about you, but it's not that she doesn't have privileges in the hospital. I don't know. It never seems to work out. I mean, and
yeah, so you could, so the question is, should your doctor have a copy? And then if you're in a hospital where that, where your doctor doesn't have privileges, obviously, you know, that doesn't help a whole lot. So let's get with copies. So in order to make it legal, I've signed it in the presence of two witnesses. Now I have this wonderful document. It does not work in a vacuum. It does not work if you keep it secret. Okay? You have to make copies of it, and people have to know about it. So who do you think are some people that should probably get a copy of this thing after you've signed it?
Your agent.
Okay, and more than one, if you've got more than one. Who else?
Your doctor.
Your doctor. Your doctors. Okay, most of us have more than one doctor these days, right? Yes, your specialist. You know, your primary care doctor, your cardiologist, any of your specialists. I had someone ask me, what about my dentist? Hey, why not? Because you know what? I could pass out in the dentist's office. You know, and use that gas stuff, and I don't know, I stand up too fast and hit my head. I don't know. It doesn't hurt, right, for people to have it. What about family members you didn't name as your agent? They need to know what's going to happen in case of emergency, who to call. Some people like to give it to their clergy. Because if that's important to them, for them to know what's going to happen if an emergency situation takes place. If you're in a school setting, you'd want to give it to your school. If you have a case manager, you want to give it to your case manager.
What if you're traveling overseas?
Okay. You should definitely have it with you or have something with you that indicates what to do in case of emergency. I don't know, you know, when you're talking about overseas, it could be any type of country, and I don't know other countries' laws regarding advance directives and how that works. I do know that in the United States, other states recognize advance directives from other states. So if you have signed it in presence of two witnesses in Virginia, so it's legal in Virginia, it will be recognized in other states, even if they have other requirements. As long as it's legally done in the state that you did it in, it will be recognized in other states. Okay. We also have a state registry in Virginia that is a free service where you can upload or fax or mail your advance directive to the state registry. You get a card that you carry in your wallet that says, I have an advance directive, and it has a PIN number on it so that even rescue squads have computers on board. So they can, I mean, your agent can get there before, get to the hospital before you do, maybe. They can call your agent, know who to call. That's also really important if you have something in your document like an allergy or a medical condition that they need to know about right away and you're unconscious and you can't tell them. That gives them access to your document. They pull it up on the computer right there.
Yeah. Maybe you can talk a little bit about maybe for folks who might not be able to make power of attorney or advance directive.
Okay.
What some of the...
Okay, so we've talked about, you know, if you haven't done any of these things, who makes decisions. And so for folks who are not able to do a power of attorney, I want to be clear here, though, when I say this. I have helped well over 200 people, all with varying disabilities, do this. And I think I'm up to 8 individuals out of those over 200 that I could not find a way to communicate, and that's on me. I know they're communicating with me, but I couldn't find a way to communicate with them, and so that they, I was not able to ethically write a power of attorney for them to sign. For some folks, life just goes on, you know? They may be seeing the same doctor, and the doctor just, even when the kid turns 18, they still let the parents continue to make decisions. And they're doing that legally through the Health Care Decisions Act because that would be the next kin for that individual. However, in the world of HIPAA and the world of getting sued, a lot of doctors these days won't do that. Once that person turns 18, they want someone to be able to give consent. And if it isn't that individual, they want someone who is recognized as the legal decision maker. And I've had doctors refuse to give treatment for very serious diagnoses, including cancer, because they didn't feel that the individual could give consent, even though Virginia has said that they have consent until they've been declared incapacitated. So, or have capacity until they've been declared incapacitated. A lot of times those folks, if they truly cannot understand the advance directive and cannot indicate their choices, then guardianship may be the option. When considering guardianship, the reason that we talk about alternatives to guardianship, well, you guys tell me, why not just do guardianship? Isn't that the easy thing to do?
We tried doing that for our adult son, and even though he was in a psychiatric crisis and totally nuts at the time, he said, "You're trying to take away my right to vote. You're going to take away my right to drive a car. I'm not." And he somehow managed from a psych ward to get a hold of a lawyer who came to court the day that we were trying to get guardianship and told the judge that he did not want it and we could not get guardianship for him because he understood that his rights were going to be taken away and he wanted no part of that.
Right. So maybe it isn't as easy. I mean, I see it as being a fairly easy process generally.
No. I want to say that you can have partial guardianship.
It
doesn't have to be for the right to vote, for the right to this. I mean, you can exclude some things out of the
right.
But they give them a piece of paper that says if someone has guardianship, these are potentially the rights that could be taken away. I mean, we assured him that we would never take away his right to vote. He happens to vote the way that we kind of agree with. And we said, you know, if you're able to drive, we would not take that right away.
But here's
but
the thing.
He got a piece of paper. Legally, he had to receive a paper before the guardianship hearing. And all those things were listed there. And when he saw that, he just...
And when you're talking about all those things listed... if you look under page 4, once declared incompetent, you use the right to, and it goes on to page 5. There's so many of them. Guardianship, it has been called civil death. And the reason for that is you do lose basically all of your civil rights that you gained when you turned 18. So unless the judge limits it, you do lose the right to vote, drive, get married, get divorced, write a will, sign a contract. And when you say that you would not take those rights away from him, it wouldn't be you, it would be the law. And unless the judge specifically protects any of those rights, they're taken away by the law immediately once a guardian is appointed. And that's one of the main reasons we look at alternatives to guardianship, because of all the civil rights that are taken away from an individual. They're basically put back into the role of a child as far as civil rights go. The other thing is that it can be expensive. You pay a lawyer, you pay for your lawyer, you pay for another lawyer called a guardian ad litem, you pay the court costs. So it's expensive as far as money. It's expensive also in terms of the individual's dignity. They often are pulled into court, and most of you as parents probably have spent your whole life talking about what your child can do, focusing on what they can do, focusing on the strengths. That's not what they hear when they go to court to get a guardian. They hear all the things they can't do. They hear all the bad decisions they've made, and they have to sit there and listen to that. And that is also a cost that's involved with guardianship. The other thing about guardianship is that once you're in it, it's very difficult to get out of it. You have to go back to court. The court is the only mechanism of getting any changes or getting that guardianship taken away. And so you've got another expense to go back and get the guardianship either changed or removed. Much easier to get a guardian than it is to get rid of one. Yes?
Now, you may get to this, but how do you decide whether guardianship is going to be appropriate? I mean, for example, if you have a child with an intellectual disability and you want them to have as full a life as possible, but... they clearly can't you know, they can make a decision whether they wear the red shirt or the green shirt, but they don't necessarily have an understanding of politics or you know.
I don't either.
Yeah, well, for example, but, you know, just don't necessarily even understand how to make change or,
right.
you know,
so,
stuff like
so
that.
So how do you decide when guardianship is the right thing? And I do want to tell you that I personally, and DLCV as an agency, is not anti-guardianship. I don't want you leaving here thinking that, but I do want you leaving here having all the information. Guardianship is a tool in the toolbox. And everything we've talked about today, those are tools that are in our toolbox for ourselves as well as our children and the folks that we support. So guardianship is a tool. It happens to be the sledgehammer in the toolbox. And if you need a sledgehammer to do this job, then the sledgehammer is the tool that you use to do the job. Just understand what the ramifications are for using that tool. But if I can show you that you only need a screwdriver and you try to use the sledgehammer, you'll probably get that screw in there, but you're going to tear up a bunch of other things in the process. That's about as far as I can go with the tool metaphor. But these are all tools in the toolbox, and none is a bad tool or, you know, even the skill saw that cut my finger off, it's not a bad tool, okay? I had no business using it. But they're all tools, and they all have a specific purpose. So what I tell parents when, you know, like the 8 or 10 or so folks could not do an advanced directive with me, it doesn't mean you have to go to the courthouse tomorrow. You know, you may go through life. I've got clients who are 40 and 50 years old whose parents are still making medical decisions for them. And they've never gone and gotten guardianship for that individual. The doctor has operated off of that list that we've talked about, that legally he can have next of kin make those decisions. And they didn't have to go for guardianship. But then, they, you know, something happens and they have to go to a specialist, a doctor they've never seen before. And then that doctor might say, wait, that person can't give consent. And I'm not taking your consent unless you have some sort of legal document. That may be the time you think about, okay, well, maybe now I need to think about guardianship.
But even, let's say they're still in a school setting, you know, because a lot of kids can stay in school to their 22nd birthday. And in order to even make decisions about their IEP, for example, if they, you know, they're considered legally adults, and but they don't necessarily have an understanding of that. I mean, how do you get around that?
What is the school telling you?
You start with a COA first. Is that what you do?
You can certainly, again, yes. If a power of attorney is possible, if that person is somehow able to say, I want mom to talk for me, and by saying that, I mean, do I ask the question in 3 different ways, and every time they nod their head or they point to mom? Or they point to a picture of mom, they blink their eyes 3 times. You know, somehow, however it is they communicate, remember? We look at however it is they take in information, however it is they communicate. If they're able to do that, then a power of attorney can come into play in a school setting as well. Okay? Yeah.
Someone on the webinar kind of asked around this question. Should someone pursue the medical or health POA first before pursuing guardianship?
Should someone pursue the medical power of attorney before they think of guardianship? I say yes, because it is the tool in the toolbox that is less invasive and would cause less, it doesn't take away any civil rights at all. It maintains civil rights. If for some reason that doesn't work or the individual can't do it, then guardianship may be the option. And I want to get to what this lady said, very important point. Even if you're looking at guardianship, we have limited guardianship in Virginia. So maybe the person can't make complicated medical decisions. Then, but maybe they can decide where they want to live and where they want to work and who they want to hang out with. You get a limited guardianship for medical decisions. Or maybe they can handle medical decisions, but they can't handle their money, and they have something other than Social Security we can get a pay for. Maybe they got an inheritance or, you know, they have estate or some sort of money that they can't handle. In Virginia, we have something called a conservatorship, very similar to guardianship, and they're often done together. Conservatorship is like guardianship, but it handles the money aspects of things. So the person is declared incapacitated to handle their money, and the court would then appoint someone to be their conservator to handle the money. Guardian and conservator can be two different people and often are. Yes?
Yeah, and a lot of people tell my daughter's 16. She has a really sweet ID. I mean, she's not, you know, doing a lot of odd things. But one of the things, they keep pushing guardianship on me to school, and they keep saying if I don't do it by 17 and a half, I'll never be able to do it again. And I think that's nonsense.
It is nonsense.
I did upset my parents, and I said I've had a lot of experience in this. And I think I'm just leaning toward KOA because she trusts me with everything.
And you're
in, I get older.
And the good thing about when you're looking at this and your child is not 18 yet, is that you're looking at, you have some time to practice on making decisions. You know, decision making and making choices is a skill. And it's a skill that we learn. When I drop my little girl off at daycare and I see a little two-year-old girl who's wearing like purple polka-dotted tights and a tutu and, you know, an orange shirt, you know, I'm thinking, okay, way to go, Mom. You let her pick out her clothes. She's learning how to make choices. Oh, God, I hope you let her pick out her toes. But, you know, that's something that we learn from the time we're babies, you know. But a lot of times, folks with disabilities, especially those with intellectual disabilities, we don't. We don't let them practice those skills. And so when it gets time to make those decisions about who's going to help you make decisions, you know, if you get sick and somebody needs to talk to the doctor, who do you want it to be? Then they're like, you know, it takes practice to make those decisions. So,
is the conservator necessarily a financial, can be a financial planner?
Can a conservator be a financial planner? Yes. Sometimes the conservator is somebody who's paid to do that, and other times it's a family member, and it could be, you know, the same as the guardian, or it could be different from the guardian. I'm going to take one more question, and then I want Megan to talk about her experience with supported decision-making in Canada. So I've got one in here and one on the web, and I'll take both of them. So the one in the live audience.
What advice do you have for a person with an adult mental health disability that for a while you're the friend, and then you blink and you're the enemy, and the friend is some predator that they just met on the internet?
You know, you're always going to go for putting these things in writing for the future when you're doing well. So I would say go for that, you know, when we're thinking clearly and we're able to make sound decisions. But the thing about writing an advance directive is you can change it at any time. There is a way to lock it in if I don't have capacity to make decisions for myself, but it goes beyond what we have time for today. Basically, you can make changes to it at any time. So I don't have probably the advice that you want for that question. And the last question from the web?
Yeah, so actually, just one quick one and then the question.
Oh, okay, you're pushing it. Okay.
So can the power of attorney be put in place when the child is a minor, or is it only effective when they're 18?
Okay, so can a power of attorney be put in place when a person is a minor, not legally? No. I talk to individuals before they reach the age of 18, but they can't make the decisions and actually sign it until their 18th birthday.
And then the other question is, you kind of talked a little bit about limited. Can you just go into a little bit detail about limited guardianship?
So go into a little detail about limited guardianship. The judge can limit the guardianship in any way that he sees fit. He can limit it in the sense that just that he can give the person the right to vote. That's considered a limited guardianship because something, some civil right has been protected. So I have a guardian, but I'm still allowed the right to vote. That's a limited guardianship. It can also be very tailored to the individual so that if the individual has certain things they can make decisions about, like where they live, where they work, then those things are protected and the guardian would not make those decisions. The judge would protect those rights for the individual to make those decisions on their own and would just appoint the guardian for those decisions the individual cannot make their own decisions for.
Is that similar with POA, with a limited POA as
well? A limited POA, I'm not...
I mean, like, if you put limitations in the POA.
You can put limitations on what your agent is allowed to do. Yeah, it's similar. With the court, obviously, it's much more formal. You know, with the judge saying what the individual has, what the guardian has the legal right, what decisions they have the legal right to make and which ones they don't. So that would make it a limited guardianship. I will say I have spoken to two parents in Virginia who petitioned the court for limited guardianship, and the judge saw fit to give full guardianship and didn't protect any of the individual's rights. And that is the judge's prerogative. He's the one that makes the final determination. So just know that if you go to court and ask for limited guardianship, it is up to the judge. And sometimes the judge doesn't know a whole lot about folks with disabilities, doesn't know that capacity is something that's different for different decisions, and you can end up with a full guardianship even if it's not what you ask for. So I'm going to pass it on to Nate.
Wonderful. So I'm going to have this. You want
to sit down over here? Out of your way? That's okay?
Yes. I'm going to dance on
and I think this is actually a good point for me to start on. So I'm going to follow up Dana's discussion of alternatives to guardianship and guardianship itself, talking about supported decision making, a term everybody's familiar with, or
raise hands?
No. Okay, all right. So I'm going to have to do two rounds of this. First, supported decision making. The idea that we all rely on supports, whether it's our friends, our family, to help us process information and make decisions. So for example, when I decided where I was going to rent an apartment here in D.C., I wasn't really sure. I hadn't lived in D.C. in a while. I asked some friends who lived in D.C. They gave me some advice, where to go, where not to go. Apparently it wasn't such great advice because I live in Rockville and I commute to Northern Virginia every day. But still, take an advice, get support, make a decision. Also to a person with a disability. It doesn't matter that I don't have one. Any person relies on support to make decisions. That's the principle behind supported decision making. Now, on top of that, I'm assuming that there are probably not many people who know in this room why I would be talking about British Columbia and supported decision making. Not just because I like Canada, but actually, British Columbia has a law. It's called the Representation Agreement Act, and it was one of British Columbia is one of the first, if not the first jurisdiction to recognize supported decision making. So that concept we just went over in law. So as a legal alternative to guardianship. So add in your arsenal, in your toolbox, is POAs, the broad scope of medical directives, but in British Columbia, there's also supported decision making. And it's been in practice since 1993, so a very long time. And so I'm here to talk about my experience working out there, seeing it in practice, and seeing how we may implement it here in Virginia. So, a little intro. I mean, you know me as the beneficiary advocate, hopefully, but I also wear a different hat as a pro bono advisor and former legal intern at NIDIS Personal Planning and Resource Center, which is in Vancouver. That is the nonprofit that's tasked with providing public legal education in British Columbia on supported decision making. That's why I'm here today. So, we're just going to talk a little bit about the context, what supported decision making in law is. Then we're going to get to the meat of it, which is the examples of what supported decision-making actually looks like. Then we're going to talk about some lessons we learned in British Columbia, some barriers, challenges that you all probably encounter here in Virginia too, and some takeaways. So what do I do if I don't live in a jurisdiction where we have this in law? So what is the Representation Agreement Act? That is BC's supported decision-making law. Its purpose is to create a legal alternative to guardianship. So when we're talking about folks who may not be able to make powers of attorney, This law was created to create an alternative to guardianship for them, so for people who weren't presumed to have capacity. And it was the result of a community-based law reform, included folks from all different kinds of backgrounds, folks with IDD, folks with psychosocial disabilities, mental health concerns, people with brain injuries, people with physical disabilities, seniors with dementia, everybody was around the table. So what is supported decision-making and how is it in this law? Well, there's two main points that I'm going to make here. Supported decision-making is included in this law because it authorizes support. An adult can authorize a representative to help them make decisions or to make decisions on their behalf. I'll put a little asterisk here. People say, well, making a decision on my behalf, that's like guardianship or substitute decision-making. That's not supported decision-making. You're not listening to me. We're going to get to that. But you authorize support for these areas: personal care, routine management of financial affairs, major and minor healthcare decisions, and obtaining legal services. So first, it's in the law because you authorize support. Second, it's an alternative to guardianship that's available to everyone. There's no specific capability criteria to make certain representation agreements. So imagine that. You have to understand and appreciate a document to make a power of attorney. Capacity standards different in British Columbia. It says, well, we're going to, you know, we don't have a precise threshold. It specifically says in the law that an adult's way of communicating is not grounds for finding them incapable. So if a person communicates through eye gaze, you can't say, I don't, they have to be able to talk for me to believe that they can give consent. You can give consent with eye gaze to form, sign one of these agreements. An adult can make an RA7, so that specific representation agreement, even if they are incapable of making a contract otherwise and or managing their affairs. So it's specifically said in law. If you don't have the ability to make a contract and you managing your affairs is a little precarious, you can still make one. So we talked a little bit, and Dana talked a little bit about this idea that decision-making and capacity are on a continuum, right? So sometimes you need more help, sometimes you need less help. Decision that I need less help with. If you ask me, Megan, it's Friday, are you going to have a glass of wine tonight? I don't need any help with that decision. I am good. I got it. Yes, I'm going to have a glass of wine. It has been a long week. But if you say, Megan, you took out a lot of student loan debt. We should start thinking about saving here for your retirement. You need to think about financial investments. You need to create a budget. You need to money into your 403B. Well, I'm going to cower in the corner, maybe start crying, and try to find that bottle of wine that I was talking about drinking on Friday. Investments go over my head. I need a lot of support. I'm going to need my brother, for example, who's the financial guru in the family. I'm going to need to contact him, and he's going to need to sit down with me and explain to me in a way that I can understand what a 403B is. And that may include breaking it down as you need money for when you can't work. This is for that. I can save for that. I can understand that. And there are some decisions that are in the middle. But the idea is that it is a spectrum, and you move back and forth. So working across that spectrum, what if you have a situation wherein the adult understands the nature and effect of a decision, and others merely help them by accessing information and doing tasks in the adult's direction? That's independent decision making. Making the decision by yourself. What happens if capacity is in question due to illness, disability, or injury? Well, then maybe in that situation, you'll need interdependent decision making, or we call it supported decision making. Now, on the other end is substitute decision making. So do you remember when I said put that asterisk when you can make decisions on somebody's behalf? So let's say that you end up in the hospital. Let's say you end up in the hospital. You're unconscious. You're in a car accident. It's after that point in time when you've, where they're just going to do life-saving procedures, and somebody has to give consent. Well, if you want your representative, who you've appointed to help you in all other situations, to still be in the room, then you have to include situations of substitute decision making. So representation agreements address the continuum. That's the idea. So most people follow along this far, and when I was working out at NIDIS, we get this far, and people say, okay, I got it. You know, this is the person I want to appoint as my representative. This is, we're good to go. Or, you know, we would have families come in and say, okay, this is what we want to do. This is, you know, this person has made this decision. Let's do it. But we would get this far, and then we would get to the portion of signing. And folks would say, well, my family member can't sign. They physically can't sign. And I know that there are situations when someone actually may be physically able to not sign, may not be able to physically sign. But this is an example that I saw, and I'll give you two examples on here. I think signing is a great opportunity to witness how people are capable. So for this guy, we walked in and he came in to make a representation agreement. Mom was going to be his representative. He got to this part, and she said, well, you know, he can't sign. He can't. Maybe he can. Maybe we can just, you know, maybe we can give it a shot. Why don't we try? No, his motor skills, he can't use it. It's not going to work. What we actually did was put pen in his mouth. This is what he did. He made a mark.
It's neater than my signature.
Yeah, it looks a lot more coherent than mine. Another example for you is that a man named Drew, his mom was prevalent in the law reform in the 90s. He went to make his representation agreement. Mom was going to be representative. He lived in a group home at the time. Staff came up to him, gave him his pen, put it in his right hand. He transferred it to his left hand and signed. Because he was left-handed. But they had never given him a pen. The problem is that we presume narratives of incapability around people with disabilities all the time, when we really should be presuming narratives of capability.
Yeah, just to give you a flip side of that, I don't want to imply that it's about capacity. It could be about a physical condition.
Right.
And so much of this is based on consent and informed consent. The physical condition may be such that it is impossible to determine whether the movement, I'm not talking about legibility or even the ability to make a mark. I'm talking about the knowledge that the mark made was a conscious mark that shows informed consent and was not the result of a seizure
or
movement that was not controlled. And when you get to that with people that have been working with an individual with that sort of disability, it is very subjective. And the circumstance can be created to sway the decision one way or the other, where half the room would believe that it was informed consent, and the other half of the room would say no way, was not, it was coerced, because there's just no way to know. And so it's not so much about physical capability to make the mark, it's about the witnesses understanding that the mark really transmits that level of meaning, because that is so important to all of us.
It is. And that's actually, so I didn't get into a lot of the, I guess now I know how this feels on this side of it. Yeah. That person asked the same question. So the statement was, you know, what if it's, you know, we can't really know from the signature that the person, that it wasn't caused by a seizure, for example. Mm-hmm. How can we know that informed consent is there? That's it's a big issue, if that's sort of summarizing in a way. In the Representation Agreement Act, and I don't want to go too much into the minutiae of the law, but it says that witnesses have to understand how the person communicates. So if it is that the witnesses all in the room understand that the person communicates by blinking, and two of the people say he blinked twice, one of the person says, I think he blinked once, there's an issue there. And we do have to get to the bottom of whether that person gave consent. But the idea is that the witnesses, it may not be apparent to me walking in the room whether that person gives consent, but the witnesses have to know. And that's what's recognized in this law. So let's get to some examples. These are the fun parts. So I changed the names a little bit.
to provide some anonymity, but let's do the story of Sam. Sam is a 45-year-old man with an intellectual disability. He is nonverbal and has many medical needs. But he is a big Vancouver Canucks fan. I don't know how many people know the Vancouver Canucks. They are the Vancouver's hockey team. This is obviously done in Canada. How does Sam's representative know that he wants to go to a Canucks game? So Sam sometimes freaks out in large crowds. By freak out, I mean he starts banging his arm. He gets vocal. He'll shut down. But he still likes the Canucks, and he watches them all the time. So this was an example. The representatives actually came in and said, this is what we're doing with our supported decision-making agreement. What do you think? To sort of get feedback. So they said, what we do is we ask Sam, before we buy the tickets, Sam, do you want to go to the Canucks game? Sam communicates through hand squeeze. So squeeze hand, yes. Okay, yes. Okay. They buy the tickets. A week before the game, Sam, do you want to go to the Canucks game? Squeeze hand, yes. Day up. We're getting dressed. Sam, do you want to go to the Canucks game? Yes. See where this is going. We get in the car. Sam, you still want to go to the Canucks game? Yes. We get just outside the stadium. Sam, Canucks game or no Canucks game? Canucks game. We get out of the car and we're starting to see the people. Canucks game? Yes. We get into the stadium with all the people. Canucks game? Yes. Canucks score a goal? Do we still want to be there? It's loud? Yes? And we're still there. Supported decision-making is a practice that's centered on listening and checking in with the adult. I use a different example here sometimes, but the idea is that you, when you put on a hat as a supporter, you are translating for that person. You are the way that that person communicates with the world. Your role may be different than a role as a mom or a dad, or brother or sister, you're always going to be those things. But in this moment, you are how that person communicates with the world. And so I'm going to read quickly an excerpt from a document that a couple of representatives put together with an individual who is nonverbal. I think that this, it's called an expression of my wishes. I'm just going to read portions of it, but it gives you an idea for folks who may not be communicate using words, what we can, how we know what their preferences are. So this reads, I express my pleasure by smiles, eye contact, and most often by bouncing my right leg up and down. Mm-hmm. I express displeasure with facial frowns, pushing people away with my arms. I don't enjoy having my teeth brushed and will try to push whomever is trying to brush them away. However, I usually give in and allow this to be done because my mom tells me I need healthy teeth and this is how I get them. I like to show I like things by bouncing my right foot, remaining alert, occasional smiles, vocalizing, making eye contact, and trying to participate to the best of my capabilities. I dislike bright sunlight and not having my sunglasses on. Me too. Strangers and people staring at me, people talking about me as if I wasn't present, getting up early and being rushed to get ready for outings. I dislike having my ears cleaned. I dislike, I show my dislike by refusing to make eye contact, frowning, clenching my teeth, and pushing my caregiver with my arms. I will cover my eyes and roll my head and my arm to indicate that I wish to put my sunglasses on. If I do this in the house and it isn't sunny out, it means that I want to go outside. This is a document, and then everybody signed at the end. This is a document that actually the representatives created with the individual. So it gives you an idea of even folks who say, well, I don't know how they communicate, I'm not sure that we can get consent. Creating something like this and sharing it with folks allows people to know when he bounces his leg up and down, that's him saying, I'm happy about this, I want you to do this. So let's move to another example. James. This is a case that I was still involved in until recently. So James is a 22-year-old man with a developmental disability. He is nonverbal. He lived in a home share situation in Vancouver. Sponsored living situation, if you guys are familiar. The idea is that you live with a family, takes care of you, and can support you. So it creates a different environment. James's parents are divorced, but they come together for James, which is great. But the problem is that the home share family in this situation moved to Vancouver Island. They don't need to know geography, just know Vancouver, and then you have to take a ferry, and then there's some mountains, and then you finally get, they moved to the other side of the island. We're talking 4 or 5 hours away. So James's parents had a representation agreement, and they said, well, I don't think James really understands that all of his services are here. All the people that he knows are here, we're here. He's not going to understand if, you know, all of this changes. He's not going to understand the repercussions of this at all. So he should stay here. Well, home share family moved, and James started wandering. And he would wander back to the neighborhood that he lived in and to the exact house. He didn't just do this once or twice. He did this repeatedly. And the parents came in and had a moment, but they looked at each other and said, he's communicating. He's telling us he wants to go. And so he went. He went to Vancouver Island, and he went to live with the home share family. So the takeaway here is that supported decision-making is about putting aside best interests and allowing adults to make decisions, even if they are decisions that you disagree with. James didn't really, I mean, he still struggles with the fact that his services are not the same. It took adjusting. But James should be allowed dignity of risk, and he should be allowed to make his own decisions. And that's the idea behind supported decision making. So just some lessons learned. A lot of text here, but really it's just the first sentence that's important. One of the greatest barriers to supported decision-making and to self-determination are our health and social service systems. So I can't stress this enough. We create narratives of incompetency around folks with disabilities all the time. To access public benefits, like Social Security, you have to talk about how incapable it is, the person is. How many of you have done a Medicaid waiver of AIDS assessment? Yeah, that's all about everything the person cannot do, right? We create these narratives, and parents and supporters learn them. And then they get blamed for slippage down the line, just like James's parents who said, well, he doesn't understand. He's incapable. That's how he qualifies for all these support services. He doesn't understand them, so he should just stay here. When really, we should be talking about how people are capable. So what we found in British Columbia, that one of the biggest barriers to recognizing alternatives to guardianship is the fact that so many of the public benefits that folks with disabilities access rely on them being deemed incapable. We have to start changing narratives around that.
Excuse me.
Sure.
I'm a little hard of hearing. Do you mind talking a bit louder?
Sure. Sorry. I can. Originally from the great state of New Jersey, so I will put on my loud Jersey voice. And if you have trouble, just keep on, raise your hand. Another challenge is the lack of education, and it's education by people with disabilities. We presume, like I said, we presume narratives of incapability just because we don't believe that folks can communicate in the same ways that we do. That doesn't mean that they're incapable. We need to hear more about their stories. And I have gotten to know a number of people across my time in British Columbia who've taught me a lot about that point. The third barrier and challenge is that you don't learn it from a book. Everyone expects you're going to be able to read a manual on supported decision making and then do it in practice. Not how it works. It's trial and error. It's like Sam's supporters who had to say, do you still want to go to the game? Do you still want to go to the game? Do you still want to go to the game? You learn it, and it's based on the individuals that you work with. So why should I care about British Columbia or supported decision-making here in Virginia where we don't have this law? Well, first, there are a couple takeaways. One important thing to do is encourage self-determination. There's huge amounts of studies around the fact that people who are more self-determined are safer. So one of the biggest issues that comes up with this law, people throw their hands up and say, what about safety? Well, if you give people the opportunity to make decisions and to say, no, I don't want something, they will develop the skills that they need to stand up to people who could manipulate them. But you have to give them the chance to do so. you can help. One example could be to help somebody make an expression of my wishes. So if they need help typing it up, writing it out, it's harder for people not to listen to you if you're saying this is how the person communicates. Do you see they're communicating right now in front of us? Practice signing and creating supported decision-making agreements. You may not be able to have it legally recognized, but it's an important practice. It builds into that self-determination. Third, if someone presumes that your loved one is incapable, put on your hat as a supporter. It's a different role than a parent, necessarily, or a sibling. You are saying, no, this is how the person is communicating. They're telling you that they don't want this. Listen to them. It starts to change the narrative around incapability of people with disabilities. Fourth, educate others about the practice. It's always helpful to get more information out there. And five, if you really want to and are feeling empowered, advocate for a law that allows everyone to use supported decision making like the law in British Columbia. We're still a little bit away to go here in Virginia. We've had laws get passed in Texas, actually in Delaware. But this is really important stuff because it does create that legal alternative to guardianship. So you don't have to go down that path even if the person cannot understand and appreciate documents. So that's what I had for today.
I wonder if you might just expand a little on the concept. You drew a distinction between in their best interest versus what they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And if you could just expand on that, if they want to do something that will be have a negative consequence for them, and it's not in their best interest.
So I'll take a personal example, I guess, for me. I wanted to move to, when I was in school, I wanted to study abroad and go to Canada, which actually ended up turning out well for me. But in the process, it didn't look like such a good option. I had to file additional paperwork, and I just wanted to go. I was really excited about moving and about going, and I had a lot of opportunities here that I left, and relationships that I couldn't follow through with because I would be living abroad. In making the decision to go, you could argue that it wasn't in my best interest. It certainly wasn't financially prudent, that I can tell you. Moving internationally isn't. And it wasn't something that I knew fully what the consequences would be. But it was something that I wanted to do, and so I did it. And so for people with disabilities, too, I mean, you can take Sam's example, or James's example. You know, was it in his best interest to go to Vancouver Island? I don't know, because all his services were in Vancouver. But he wanted to be with that family. It means that he wasn't going to see his parents as often, which for me could be a perk. But, you know, there is that give and take. So does that answer your question a little bit? Or?
Yeah, I'm just thinking of situations where they get themselves deeper and deeper into some, you know, legal conundrum because they're making poor decisions. You know, if you don't do this, then you will get fired from your job and, you know, that kind of thing.
So as far as,
it takes to get fired in order for him to learn and don't do it the next time.
Yeah, to reiterate the question is, you know, what do you, you know, there's sort of this spiral effect and you keep on making bad decisions and it's leading you down a line where you're in worse and worse of a situation. Well, step one is to see if you can, you know, if you're drawing out consequences of all these actions and writing them down. This is something I used to do with a friend when he was bipolar, and so when he would go manic, I would write down the things that he did and then share them to him afterwards and say, this is what was happening. This is what you were feeling. You can make your own decisions about what your life is and where you're going, but there are certain things that I'm not going to be able to help you with at a certain point, and there are certain decisions that have major repercussions. So what we've worked out is an opportunity where, a situation where he has identified at what point he wants me to step in. But where that isn't possible, or whether it just keeps on spiraling, it's about, you know, having an open conversation about consequences and knowing, you know, and allowing the person to make mistakes. I mean, unfortunately, maybe it is losing the job that helps them learn, like you said, that you can't do the behavior.
Getting that credit card at 18 that took me years to pay off once I realized it wasn't free money. You know, that was not in my best interest, and had I listened to my parents, I wouldn't have done it. But I did it, and I had to pay the consequences for it. And the thing with dignity of risk is you're not going to let someone run into the street in front of a car. I mean, that's not dignity of risk. I'm sorry, that's stupidity. You're not going to let someone truly get hurt to the point of where there's no coming back from it. But if it's a situation where they're just going to suffer consequences that may be painful at the time, it may be how they learn.
Yeah.
With the support around them as they're suffering the consequences, and not an I told you so mentality, which fortunately my parents didn't do with me. But
Gina, do you see how I have a cousin who I'm sure I'm on his team as he gets older. His mother has identified me to one of the members of his team, whether it's power of attorney and one of three cousins, that will help with as far as money and organizing things for him if she were to pass away. But that said, so many consequences that could possibly happen, they don't just impact him. They impact the entire family, or if he were to lose his job, that means something drastic for the rest of the family, for him to help find services, to help find another job, you know. So it's not just consequences. Like, if it was just for a person without disabilities, it just seems to be magnified, and that the consequences are not just for the individual, it's for the whole family unit. And because they are that big, and I think we're probably all more protective and say, okay, let's try and avoid the consequences if any of us see those consequences. We're on the lane for certain consequences happen. We want to avoid that, not only because we want to protect him, but because we just don't want to do all that extra stuff it's going to take if he endures the consequences. And so it kind of leaves us like, yeah, we want him to learn, we want him to be independent, but at the same time, we're like, I don't want to go through all that extra stuff, and we're trying to avoid the extra stuff for him, too.
Well, and one thing to consider is, what is the consequence of not allowing the person to do what they want to do?
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to sabotage the job anyway and end up, nobody's happy, including the individual, because they didn't get to do what they wanted to do, and they lost their job. I mean, so there are consequences to not allowing the individual to make decisions as well. There's got to come a point when you've got to decide, make that decision. Is this, you know, is this the decision that you know, he's going to learn from his mistakes? And, I mean, I mentioned the credit card mistake. That's an easy one for me, and it's one that people relate to. If you had all day, I could tell you all the other mistakes I've made in my life. And some of them have had much higher consequences for me and for others. So.
Well, one of the mistakes that guardianship has helped me with, and really the main one, is protection from the predators. Because if it's not in place, you have no standing. So I'd love to have some alternative to guardianship that I could use to protect her from those predators.
And then, too, in some situations, and the question is, especially the statement, you know, guardianship will helps me protect against people who are threatening abuse and neglect situations or predators.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's true. Ultimately, though, I wonder, you know, what we saw is that safety is in people. Safety is not in a legal document that can come and protect you. If the person that you support is going to make decisions, they're going to make them anyway, and then you just have to come after them and fix them up and try to stop them. But people will often act first, and then you're left cleaning it up. And if you're, I mean, you could be in the same situation with the power of attorney and have it, that could have been a battle. You could be in the same situation with the power of attorney.
The thing to know about guardianship, following up on that, is guardianship does not control behavior.
more succinct way of putting it.
Yeah, so I've had, you know, parents tell me they want to get guardianship, and I had one lady, why? Well, my son will not go to his doctor's appointments. He has a major medical health issue, and he needs to go to the doctor, and he won't go. And I said, how is a guardianship order going to get him to the doctor's office? It's not a magic carpet. I didn't say that to her, but I said it in my head, because I'm not that mean. But, you know, guardianship will not control behavior. And another mom who said, I think I need to get guardianship with my son. He's just discovered girls, and I'm really afraid about what's going to happen. You know, he's an adult, and what's going to happen if he does something with a girl? And guardianship is not going to do anything for that. So guardianship does not control behavior, and I think that's something that's important for people to know.
You mentioned you were going to tell us about where we should keep the documentation.
Okay, so state registry is a good place to keep it. Make sure people get copies of it. That's the most important thing. Whoever needs copies, they need to have them. Whatever you do, do not put your only copy in your safe deposit box. When does your family get access to that? When you're dead, okay? Oh, wow, she really didn't want life support. I wish I'd known that before she died. This document, people have to know about it. So where do you keep it? Everywhere. Everywhere. I mean, I do have people that carry theirs, but, you know, if it's on the state registry, you can just have a card on you that says, I have an advance directive in case of emergency. This is who you call. Sorry, I have the hiccups. You can do that. People need to know about this document and what to do in case of a crisis situation.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you guys online. Bye-bye.